I want to thank Dr. Charan and the program committee for creating a very unique scenario. It's going to be a little different than the typical Spetzler, Rosenwasser dog and pony show. This is, as I thought through this, it's a little bit like a board examination, and these fledgling experts are like candidates, and you're the board. So it turns the table a bit on these guys. And like Itzhak Perlman did on Monday, he was able to communicate his thoughts, his styles, with just holding his violin. He didn't actually play it very much, and we're expecting the same today. So why are we having discussions like this, a debate sort of clip coil, endovascular open by our combatants? And I think if I could just open with a couple of thoughts, it's because we don't have great evidence-based medicine to guide these decisions. We have to think about such things as the lesion itself. For that specific patient, what about the natural history or their daughter sex, the morphology? The size, of course, is important, but the location, the durability of various treatment options, the short and long-term risks have to be considered. And also the patient items, age, comorbidity, underlying neurological deficit, access for endovascular therapies, body habitus for surgical interventions, understanding of the risks of each option and the natural history risk in contrast. What about your environment? The local volumes and expertise, very important for outcomes. The local assets of human and technological assets, neuroanesthesia, critical care, OR and IR staffing, infrastructure, how do you handle complications at your site? What about transfer options? And it's an art to come to a decision-making and then to execute. It has to be individualized. We usually don't have good evidence-based guidelines to go with. It's a complex relationship with the patient, family, and physician, and based on trust. And I'm going to present a few cases, and I'd like to start, since all of you were here for Dr. Hopkins and Dr. Levy's presentation, do you remember the first carotid that they did? Let's just take that roughly 80% lesion, irregular, at about C3-4, symptomatic with TIAs, and I would like to ask our two experts, who I hate to compare to Mr. Perlman, but we'll call them experts. Robert, what is your reaction? Robert Rosenwasser, can you hear me okay? Dr. Hopkins' first case that was done live, the carotid stenosis, symptomatic. How would you approach? Do you agree with the way Nick handled that, or would you do it differently?
Well, I would tell you that, that certainly the CREST trial has changed the way we do things. And quite frankly, at our institution, those patients are now getting endarterectomy, not a stent. So, you know, I think with the tortuous anatomy and things like that, high bifurcation, I think that can be challenging, and certainly those cases can be considered for stenting. But I will tell you, after the CREST trial was completed, our endarterectomy volume went up dramatically. And certainly there are certain anatomic configurations like very high bifurcation, et cetera, where endovascular options are a consideration. But you,
you don't think the novel approach that Dr. Hopkins used would change your mind? The full reversal and so forth?
You know, I think the jury's out. I'm a believer in keeping it sweet and simple. I think intuitively flow reversal is very attractive. We saw how well it works, but I think the jury's still out on that, and we are still using filter protection, distal protection. I was just kind of interested to see how they're not doing pre-dilatations, they're actually doing post-dilatations. Once again, I think it's a concept to consider.
Dr. Spetzler, how would you react to that case?
I thought it was fascinating. I mean, as a preamble, I have to say that the elegance of going through the vascular tree is incredibly attractive, and I'm sure that's going to continue to evolve. If Nick Hopkins takes this long opening an endarterectomy, as he does during those two cases from end to end, I'm not surprised that he continues to do this very long, complicated procedure. where he makes an incision a little bit below the bifurcation, so he can put a catheter in it. If he would just move that incision up 2 centimeters, he could have done the whole endarterectomy at the same time. I think seriously, though, the proof is in the pudding. I think something that we haven't really addressed is the DWI lesions that occur any time you place a catheter in the vascular tree. They occur whether you just do angiography, they occur more when you manipulate and do aneurysms, or endovascular endarterectomy. We published a paper in neurosurgery with 50 consecutive microsurgical endarterectomies with pre- and post-operative look for DWI lesions, not a single lesion. I think that's what we have to compare to. We can't just use the gross exam anymore. We have to really look at the fine, long-term consequences of manipulating the vascular tree.
Thank you. We're going to move
on. The last thing is, I mean, this procedure that we saw is elegant, but it's got to be multiple more expensive than an endarterectomy.
Thank you. We're going to move through some cases, and like the boards, we may interrupt you. If it's clear you don't know what you're doing or you do, we'll just interrupt you and move on to another case. This is a woman who's brought to your emergency room after her car strikes a tree. She's reported to be in GCS 8 condition with some facial contusions and abrasions. And her CT has been done by the time you arrive. And this is the CT scan. Dr. Spetzel, you want to react to that CT?
I'm looking at this, but I don't see anything wrong.
So, home and clinic, I agree.
In our job, first of all, we've never showed this scan because you are crossing HIPAA violation here by showing that data. But nevertheless, you're from Texas, so we're going to forgive you that. The next step here would clearly be a CTA to define the lesion.
So the workup was done, and this is of a variety of techniques, but this is the representative anatomy of the intercommunicating complex. So here you have a patient in pretty good shape neurologically. What would be your approach, Dr. Spessler? How would you handle this?
It depends on the day the patient is admitted. We have a alternating microsurgical, endovascular priority, so that the endovascular surgeon would look at this and say, if this is an appropriate lesion for endovascular treatment, they would go ahead and treat it.
Well, it's actually, she was driving home from work on Friday, and it is Friday at 7 p.m. in the evening.
Oh, so they would be home naturally. So we would be taking the patient to surgery and treating her effectively.
So you would operate?
Naturally.
Dr. Rosenwasser.
Okay, so I think there's a few disclaimers here that we have to make. About 5 minutes ago, we found out that we were not allowed to show our slides and data. So this is all a new setup here. But I would tell you, this patient would be operated on. There's not a good endovascular option.
Why am I here?
Well, you know, when we were talking,
we agreed with me about everything.
Well, you know, we saw the academy. I said, they picked the wrong guy because I'm not a zealot. But, you know, this patient would be cleft.
What is your thought process? Why are these not amenable to coiling, or why would you take them to the operating room?
Why would we do it?
For Dr. Rosenwald, yeah. Yes.
Well, okay, so first of all, I think anatomical configuration is not ideal for endovascular. Smaller aneurysms have higher risk of endovascular treatment. You know, the first coil and the second coil is certainly the last coil are the most dangerous. And in our data, what grade was she?
She's grade 3.
She's grade 3. So, you know, essentially, we did a trial very similar to BRAC, but it wasn't randomized. We had a 16% crossover rate where 247 patients that we wanted to coil couldn't be coiled. Those went to surgery. Less than 60, grade 1, 2, or 3, anterior circulation, the results were identical with open surgery at endovascular. And this anatomical configuration will not have an ideal endovascular route. In addition, this patient has a fairly large intracerebral component, too. So, you know, I think if you get into mischief, And many times in this kind of situation is where you may need anticoagulation. You know, we don't systemically heparinize for endovascular treatment anymore, but if you get into mischief with this and you have to anticoagulate, you've got a real problem because you've got that significant intracerebral hemorrhage.
Okay, so the board examiners are going to interrupt this love fest where both candidates agree. We'll move to another case. This is a 46-year-old woman, sudden severe headache, negative CT scan, but a positive lumbar puncture. She's in good shape, and I'll go through her imaging. This is her one carotid. I'll be able to flip back through these. This is her contralateral carotid. A vertebral injection. Lateral. What are your thoughts? Dr. Spessler, patient in good shape, a non-localizing negative CT. Good history, though.
Can you show that internal carotid artery angiogram again? What did you see on the internal carotid artery?
When you look at all the studies, your neuroradiologist feels that she is showing at least early signs of moyamoya disease.
Exactly.
Bilaterally.
I think very significant because you can watch the collateral going around. And if you go back to the basal artery aneurysm, this is obviously a very high-risk lesion. It's a high-risk lesion from any treatment perspective. I would ask my endovascular colleague whether they think they have good access to fix this. I can tell you that on Friday, I operated on a lesion just like this, except that there was a big coil mass up on top of the recurrence, a young woman from Norway. And the only treatment option that we really considered as reasonable was to occlude the basilar artery proximal to the SCAs. But before we do that, and in this case, you required a bypass because there was not collateral flow from the internal carotid arteries to the pecans. So we were considering a bypass already, but before we ever do that, we always inspect the aneurysm just to make sure that it really isn't treatable. And fortuitously, actually, there was enough room between the coil mass and the regrowth of the aneurysm so that it could be clipped directly. So looking without feeling the pressure of actually proceeding, I think it's a perfectly reasonable way to proceed.
And what if you were going to get lucky and this was going to be reconstructable, what sort of temporary occlusion time would you anticipate, and would the carotid disease affect your decision-making process?
As opposed to the Texas school of thought, I don't use a lot of temporary clips unless they're necessary. Like in that case from Friday, there was no temporary clip utilized for the aneurysm. But if I did, I would be not concerned about the length of time because the patient would be under normal or high blood pressure. They would be under burst suppression anesthesia. And you keep it on for as short of a period as possible to get the job done.
Dr. Rosenwasser, what are your thoughts about this patient?
I think one of the comments you made about local, what goes on locally. I think if you're in Phoenix, you can have surgery for this. I will tell you, if you're in Philadelphia, don't have surgery for this. You know, it's got all the dangerous features, its size, its posteriorly pointing, et cetera, and the interfibrillation disease. In our institution, we would do this endovascularly with a Y-stent technique.
Stent and coil.
Stent and coil, or flow diverter. But most likely, this would be a Y-stent technique and endovascular occlusion.
Okay, thank you. This is a 60-year-old man. He's had gastric bypass surgery, and this lesion was picked up as an incidental finding, and I'll show you several images here. This one is probably the best. If you look at all the different variations of the anatomy here, this appears to be fusiform, with a bit of stenosis at the origin and terminating in the bifurcation, exiting the lesion at that point. Dr. Rosenwasser, you get to go first here.
Well, you know, I think this is a complex lesion in any way you look at it. I would tell you that most likely with a lesion like this, there really are not currently good endovascular options. The problems that we've had in putting stents in M2 are primarily thromboembolic. I think a flow diverter in this location is concerning because of the lenticular stries, although we do know with pathology the lenticular stries are often pushed medially or pushed laterally by the lesion. But I think that a lesion like this, which I have seen not infrequently, generally would be occlusion and bypass, not an endovascular option, because the recurrences that we see after endovascular treatment of this are then very, very difficult to deal with. So it would be bypass and occlusion.
Thank you. Dr. Spitzler.
Agreed.
They won't put us together again, I'm sure.
You know, the cervical carotid looked like that, by the way. So we got a similar case here, but with some nuances. He's 66, headache, confusion, and spastic hemiparesis, fair amount of flare signal around this mass, and CTA is shown here, and representative angiography is here with the exiting middle cerebral at that site. Are there differences in your thought process from what you previously talked about, and if you want to go with a bypass and Hunterian strategy, what sort of graft would you think about using? Robert first. Professor.
I think this is one that is perfect for a combined procedure. You've got an aneurysm. It appears like the middle cerebral artery is filling slowly, but it really isn't. It's because it's filling the aneurysm first, and then it goes out later. So you've got the whole middle cerebral complex you've got to deal with. This kind of aneurysm, if you do a lot of manipulation, it's very easy to hurt the surrounding brain. So I would do a bypass here, and then I would ask Philippe or Cameron to occlude the middle cerebral artery right where you have the takeoff of the aneurysm, and leave everything else alone, and that aneurysm will slowly get smaller and smaller.
So you would not trap?
I would not trap it.
And what sort of graft would you use?
What sort of what?
What sort of bypass graft?
Either a double barrel STA to the two major branches of the middle cerebral artery, or a short radial artery graft.
So we had a combined approach. Dr. Rosenwasser, how would you approach it?
Once again, it would be a combination of bypass and occlusion. And I think that we always do a temporary occlusion on these beforehand, and that helps us guide our bypass. Oftentimes, you're really surprised. You do a temporary occlusion. You can do flow studies, either technetium or a flow study. If they have a large ischemic penumbra, even though they're neurologically intact with the temporary balloon up, then those patients probably need a high-flow bypass. If, on the other hand, they compensated, they may perhaps just a little parietal ischemia, radiographically, not clinically, then we would do a low-flow bypass.
Would you occlude the vessel proximally with endovascular or open technique?
You know, we would probably do an endovascularly occlude this, and I would be interested to know what Robert thinks in terms of timing of anticoagulation after the bypass. We do anticoagulate these during occlusion. How long do you wait after you do a bypass?
If they want to occlude it the next day in order to get the demand, I don't have any trouble with that.
So the next day?
Ideally, you'd love to be able to put a clip on that proximal where the aneurysm takes off. But the amount of manipulation that would take with that huge mass sitting in the hemisphere, it's going to cause a problem. It's not that it can't be done. It's a matter of risk-benefit analysis.
If you had to do, let's say that the temporary occlusion showed a major flow deficit and you did a radial artery graft, for example, would you be willing to occlude the vessel at the same time endovascularly rather than wait till the next day?
I would wait till the next day.
Robert?
Generally would wait a day.
Agreed? Okay. We're going to change gears slightly. We've got a 53-year-old man, sudden onset, headache, vomiting at work. He comes in with a CT scan that you're seeing here. The only finding here was a suspicious lesion here and a small subdural hematoma on the right. You see better there. His MRI showed some suspicious vasculature at the cranial base. And this is his right common carotid angiogram. AP, his left, and the same.
All right, cut it short. I mean, we're not going to disagree on this one. It's an ethmoidal dural arteriovenous fistula, and the only appropriate treatment is clipping it as it comes out of the dura, right?
I agree.
He agrees. 46-year-old woman, incidental discovery on a headache workup. There's your lesion. 46. Non-smoker, no family history. This was a dominant but not fetal posterior oblique day. Dr. Spencer.
If you go back to the lateral, you could see how high that basilar artery is in relationship to the posterior clinoid. This one, I would beg my two endovascular colleagues to find a reasonable treatment for.
Dr. Rosenwasser, how would you approach it?
I agree. That's the thing. That's the image that catches our eyes, that how high this is. We would try a combination of stenting and coiling. I will tell you, in the acute phase of subarachnoid hemorrhage, this was an incidental finding.
Yes.
Yes. I mean, so again, loaded with clavage, aspirin, and coil this. And I would just submit to you that, for those of you in the audience that don't do a lot of endovascular, but are the surgeons taking care of these, the problems we get into with thromboembolic events after coiling or stenting is either clavage resistance, which is real, and it's really important, I think, to get people like wells on all these, know where they are. We always make certain that the patients are at least 30 or 50% inhibited. And we cancel cases if they're not 30% or 50% inhibited in terms of platelet function. Because those are the patients that get the thromboembolic problems. But we would use end coil.
Would you consider no intervention at this point in a 46-year-old? 46.
46? With this lesion, no. We would treat it. We would not have observed.
Would you ever watch that patient, Robert? Especially?
I'd watch her come into the office, leave the office, and go on her way to my endovascular colleague.
Pre-admission testing first, yeah.
Well, I think the candidates have marginally passed. We'll give them a C+, but they will be released to practice. Thank you for your participation.